on a tourism, and they created this simple one-sentence definition for sustainable tourism that stands out very much today, which is really a guiding beacon for who we are. Look at the definition of sustainable tourism. It doesn't talk only about the environment. It mentions social issues. And look at that, host communities. It's a rather interesting concept. In the past, we didn't think about that so much. Tourism has all been about the profits and the business operations of businesses. And so this is a very important, I think, moment in the history of tourism, is to have that recognition that tourism needs to serve the host communities, needs to protect community, needs to protect social conditions and so forth. That happened in the year 2005. They did much more than that, but I think this definition was very important work. That laid the groundwork to move further and deeper into a definition for sustainable tourism. So those two UN agencies worked with the conservation community. WWF was prominent, Rainforest Alliance, Conservation International, many others. These five organizations we really kind of consider sort of the more formal founders that worked together to create GSTC in 2007. So we're an NGO, we're a nonprofit organization, we're not in the United Nations system, but as you can see, the United Nations system was very instrumental in the founding of us, and we followed their guidelines along the way. In the upper right corner, you see the logo of the One Planet. This is the UN's current major project and initiative on sustainable tourism. They work in six sectors of the global economy to apply the SDGs, the Sustainable Development Goals. So travel and tourism is one of those six. And we've been members of that organization, the One Planet Initiative, from the start. So we stay close to the United Nations, but we're independent, a separate entity. So we started in 2007, and the first thing we did was to create global standards for industry, starting with hotels and tour operators. They were publicly released in the year 2008. Then you see the years that the two revisions took place. We revised the criteria approximately every 4 or 5 years. Then later, as the global community of thought leaders, many of them are in this room today, more and more was talking around the years 2008 and 9 and 10 that we really need some guidance for the public sector. It's not just about businesses moving towards sustainability. We need destination managers. We need public policy makers to set policy and to interact with the private sector to make tourism more sustainable. So there were discussions on how to do that, and out of that, one of the major outcomes of some discussion on that was for GSTC to be engaged in the creation of sustainable baseline standards for the world for the public sector. So the destination criteria are the result of that. And the GSTC destination criteria really perform two functions in the public sector. One is guidance at the policy level, and the second is a blueprint, a manual for managing destinations more sustainably. So think of those two levels for the destination criteria, policy and actual guidance to manage a destination. I put on the slide this logo of this organization, ICEAL Alliance, and what is that about? Our founders put right into our bylaws and into our DNA to follow the pattern that had been led largely by WWF and other conservation organizations to create in other sectors eco-labels and certification schemes based on global standards. The first of those was the Forest Stewardship Council in 1993, and there's a whole series of them. We were very much modeled to follow those and to follow this organization called the ICEAL Alliance. The ICEAL Alliance has three codes for operating certification schemes and accreditation in sustainability in all sectors. And we have adhered as strongly as we can to the ICEAL Alliance codes from our inception. And so when we create the criteria and we revise them, we go through a very methodical process of inclusion to follow the ICEAL Alliance standard setting code and various pieces of various ISO standards on how to manage standards. And so we have within our organization an international standards working group. Both co-chairs are here. Richard Denman, many of you know, have been very prominent in the space. Kelly Bricker, our vice chair, co-chair of the International Standards Working Group, to oversee a process that's incredibly inclusionary. When both sets of criteria were first created, we had literally thousands of pieces of input with a major outreach globally asking people from the private sector, public sector, civil society, academia, consultants, anybody and everyone for their input on how they define sustainability in travel and tourism. And then we put a methodical process of compiling all that information. And so this year, when we revised the destination criteria for the first time, we've spent more than a year on this process. We did initially a public consultation call for input. We sent out some 14,000 email messages to people in our network who have signed up to stay in touch on this. Hundreds of trade associations asking them to cascade out. We held workshops all over the world and gathered a huge amount of input after these years to see from field testing, from field use, are the GSTC destination criteria suitable or should we revise them? So we took that amount of data, all that input, and spent months gathering that, and then we created a draft version of revision, and we took that to a second public consultation to review the draft revision. And that was then reviewed, and we took edits, edited that from that input, and today we have a final product that tomorrow our board of directors will formally ratify that for our first revision of the criteria. So the point here is that this is a very methodical process, extremely inclusionary. We have input from all the continents of the world. We have input from private, public, civil society, academia, everyone. So these are not our standards. These are your standards. These are the world standards. We're the proud keepers and proud managers of a process. This is essential for you to understand. These are the criteria are applicable to all societies, rich and poor, north and south, east and west, regardless of political culture and so forth. So this is a very important piece to understand. And so we are, in a sense, sort of your humble servants of managing this process. They're not our standards, they're your standards. Here's what they look like. Each set of the standards have a specific, have approximately 41 criteria. And then within each criterion, there are multiple performance indicators. And this time, for the first time, we formally applied them directly to the SDGs. So in the past, we've mapped the criteria to the UN Sustainable Development Goals, but this time we're formally putting it in, because we believe very strongly that what better roadmap could you have to follow the UN Sustainable Development Goals is to have this global team working on doing precisely that, customizing guidance to the SDGs for travel and tourism. So you can go to our website and download these. Most standards in the world you pay for. ISO standards, you pay a fee, usually about 158 Swiss francs, about 158 US dollars, and that's the norm in standards. As part of our mission, we make the GSTC criteria available in the public domain free of charge. We give our intellectual property away for free because we want very much to use them for guidance, for awareness raising, and make them available. So you can go to the website, download them for free, use them in training, use them in awareness. We've translated them into many languages, many global languages. We do all of our technical work in the English language because when we get into some very technical matters of assessments and certification, every word was precisely chosen. So we need the universal language to apply them in a systematic and scientific way. But as training devices, as training materials, we've translated them into many, many languages. So you can go to our website and download them. Both sets of the criteria are based on four pillars, and they are very much aligned with that 2005 UN definition of sustainability, that it's not just about environment, but it's about social issues, economic sustainability of businesses, about cultural elements. When we talk about culture, we're talking about cultural preservation of heritage, and we're talking about respect for living culture, protection of indigenous rights, and protection of ethnic minorities and local cultures by cultural majorities are built into the criteria. Social elements, tourism has great power to do great good, and it has power to do bad. And so there are criteria on social issues. Look at the language of B, C, and D, those sections of the criteria. What do they have in common? Those three all have these words: maximize the benefits and minimize the negative impacts. And I think this is a very important part of the concept of sustainability, is to do more good and less harm. And that's built into the criteria. So they provide very specific guidance. One could have made a set of criteria with 200 elements, but we truly feel that through the very inclusive, intensive process to put them into the package we have of approximately 41 in each set, these are really the core issues. They're not weighted because they've already been condensed into what the inclusive group thinks are the core pieces that need to be worked on. Speaking of languages again, as I mentioned, the criteria translated into many languages. A little bit more than a year ago, we launched a Spanish version of our website, and next year we plan to launch a Chinese version of the website. We are truly global and have that outreach. A very quick word on terminology. The word sustainable is used in many different ways, and there's a great deal of confusion about it. I want to just say a couple of things. It's already been said this morning that we see sustainability as a journey, as a process. And you'll see through this presentation that all of our activities are related to development and onward and upward movement and improvement. And the UN said it itself in 2017 in the International Year of Sustainable Tourism for Development that sustainable tourism as a term should be viewed as an aspiration. Sustainable tourism is not a noun. It's not a type of tourism. What we're talking about here is tools and process and orientation to make all forms of tourism more sustainable. So I just want to share some thoughts about generally what are the role of standards in the world. Now, the GSTC criteria are a set of standards. So let's reflect for a moment on what is the value of them. Well, first of all, I've talked about the value of using them for training and awareness. If we polled you and asked you the question of what does sustainability mean to you, we would get so many different answers. And so we feel that we play a very valuable role through that inclusive process to create the criteria to define them in a holistic manner. So first and foremost, and please never let go of this, that the GSTC criteria are a phenomenal training tool to raise awareness on what we truly mean by sustainability. So, and again, they're available free of charge to use. So first and foremost, and everything comes back, I think, to awareness and training of what sustainability is. Standards help with standardization, to have a common language, a common framework. They can be guidelines for regulatory codes. Often today's voluntary standards become the basis for legal codes. For measurement and evaluation, and we'll talk about certification, that they're used as the basis of certification. So let me tell you about the various projects and activities, programs that we have at GSTC. So first of all, more than anything, we're all about the GSTC criteria, our standards, that we're the keepers and managers of the criteria and the distributors of them. And we have these various programs and activities that all are derived from the criteria. Everything we do is very much driven from the criteria. Because we believe very strongly that sustainability needs to be understood first before you can get good at practicing it, we've developed our own internal sustainable tourism training program. And we've created this program really globally. We have training going on throughout the world in many languages, many countries throughout the world. We've developed a team of highly qualified GSTC trainers, several in the room today. These are people with meaningful qualifications and experience in teaching. And we have them in Japanese and Chinese and Spanish and Thai and many, many languages of the world. And so we've got this team of trainers. We often have training as part of development projects. Government agencies support it. Trade associations support it. So we encourage you to use our training program of qualified trainers and our curriculum of teaching sustainability by teaching the curriculum, teaching based on the criteria to your stakeholders. The more people that are frontline people that are working in tourism that know these concepts, the better your organization, public sector or private sector, will perform if your people understand what it is we're talking about. So we've got that program, and our training director, Ayako Zaki, is here with us in the second row. All of our staff, by the way, we're very transparent. You can go to our website, in the About section of our website, and you'll see photos of faces, and you'll see email addresses of all of us. So we're very reachable and transparent in who we are and what we do. Destination stewardship is a key piece of what we're doing because as the keepers of the destination criteria, we often help governments and others really understand what we're talking about with what destination sustainability is. A word on the word. This is sometimes a bit of a controversial word, destination stewardship. And this is this word doesn't, stewardship doesn't translate very well into many languages of the world, but we stay with it because in English, the word stewardship is really referring to management issues, but management that cares. Almost a paternal or maternal relationship of something, to take good care of it. A steward of something is a person who takes care of it. And so I think that idea of caring, of respect for something, that's built into this. We could just say good management or something like that, but we leave it that way in English. And for you linguists that are using it in other languages, please understand the concept behind it. But the concept is destination management that is fair, just, social, that cares. That's what stewardship is about. So what are we doing? Well, we have a variety of activities. One is that I'm going to talk a little bit more generally about certification and accreditation, but we have three organizations that you see the logos on the screen, Green Destinations, EarthCheck, which we've celebrated here this morning for certifying the Azores as a sustainable destination, and Vireo. These three organizations have gone through an accreditation process, which I'll describe here in a few minutes. But we work with various governments and entities around the world. We very quietly do some destination assessments for destinations. And we don't like to promote it because we're also engaged in the world of certification, which is a prize for excellence. An assessment is something at a very lower level where we just come in and in the background assess how well a management unit is doing on their sustainability. It's just a scorecard of where they are today. So we can come in a very neutral, objective way, come into a destination and talk to the municipal government and all the different agencies and analyze what they're doing. Not only do they have policies, but they have to show us evidence that they're putting things into practice. I hope if you're new to us, you're seeing that what we're about here is a very systematic approach to sustainability. We're putting checklists to things, we're putting measurement, we're putting science behind things. Governments around the world come to us and say that they want to do, they want to create some kind of program. We immediately say this to them, don't do it. Don't create your own national certification program. They're extremely difficult to build. They're harder to operate and to maintain over the course of time. And so one of our sessions here today is we're actually going to talk about that topic of the existing certification bodies in the world who are the experts on certifying and auditing, partnering with national governments to work with them on that. So that's one of the topics of our conference. The country of Indonesia is decided to go their own way because they're just such an enormous country, 400 million population and thousands of islands. So they've got the resources and they wanted a major leadership directly from their Ministry of Tourism to coach the very small destinations, many of them very undeveloped and so forth. So we've been coaching them on that and trying to integrate them with the certification bodies that work with us. So that sort of thing. So then we've got assessors that go out and do these assessments, and we have advisory sessions, and then we customize training for policymakers. We do actually quite a bit of that. So we've done it in many countries throughout the world where we can come in and just customize maybe a two-day session to talk to the policymakers and explain sustainability management concepts. So this is our roadmap to a sustainable destination, is that first the leadership grasps, understands and adopts the GSTC criteria as a starting point, workshops and training for government stakeholders to understand what it is we're talking about, and then develop from there plans with them how to train other stakeholders, how to set policy frameworks and so forth. And a very key concept to us is that in the lower right in the red is that a council, it's actually in the middle, the destination council is created. And we feel that's extremely important. Even though the GSTC criteria are not weighted, as I said, what's been criterion A2, it's changing to A1 in the new revision, is that a destination should create a council where you have a group of people that work as a whole government approach. It can't be just the tourism people doing this. We need the public utilities, we need finance, we need education, we need a whole government approach to manage tourism effectively. Whether at the national level, provincial level, or municipal level, we need a whole government approach, and we need to reach out to the private sector and engage with them in a meaningful way on a regular basis. So some kind of council. So this is not creating a new bureaucracy. This is just a commitment from some level of government, at a high level of government, to say, we're committed to creating this group that will meet regularly and coordinate all the different pieces that we need to work on. We think that's essential. We see that there's very little of it happening in the world, but we see it extremely successful to create that council. Here's an example of what I mean. The WTTC Tourism for Tomorrow Awards are what I consider really some of the finest awards we've seen globally in sustainable tourism. Lead Judge Graham Miller with us. Thank you, Graham, for joining us. And the reason I show this is that you've heard the expression that a picture can tell a thousand words in a picture. I think this photo has many thousands of words, and I'll try to reduce it to just a few for you. The island of St. Kitts and Nevis in the Caribbean were this year's winner of the Destination Stewardship of the Tourism for Tomorrow Awards. Look at the text of some of the what's interesting is that the judging panel, and that's me on the left side, by the way. I was not on that judging panel. I was on another category, so there was no conflict of interest, right, Graham? And that's our Kathleen Pessalon on the right side, who does a lot of our work in the Americas and the Caribbean. But this group was one of what we called our early adopters. As we were creating the destination criteria, we had 14 destinations around the world that helped us in the creation of the criteria, and then they field tested late drafts of the criteria. So the final draft of the first version of the destination criteria already had field testing built into it, 14 very diverse destinations throughout the world. And so St. Kitts and Nevis was one of them, and they went through that process. Jeremy Sampson, the new head of Travel Foundation, was the on-site person conducting that one. They took the council concept to heart. They created the council, and all these years later, the council still meets and has impacts. And this is what impressed the judges, because within the GSTC criteria, you have stakeholder engagement, you have public participation, you have all the environmental controls, you have a process. And the fact that from 2012, when they learned these concepts, and in 2013, when they created the council is alive and well today and thriving. Much has been said of large ship cruising, whether that's good for the community or not. These people are extremely happy with large ship cruising. Some of the academics in the room may know that there's been studies that in some places a large ship cruise only nets $2 per person if they come off the ship for just a couple of hours. They're averaging over $100 per person off large ships coming to their island. They're very happy. They've managed it well. They've got the right experience, and they're all happy with it. The two ladies in the center tell an important story, and this is a pattern that we see all around the world, that the two ladies in the center, the one on the left is the Minister of Tourism. We see everywhere in the world ministers of tourism come and go. And usually they change the people out. So if there was someone working on sustainable tourism in 2013, that person's gone in 2015 because we've got a new agenda. The destinations and the governments of the world that are doing this well are maintaining some internal capacity with some continuity to follow these things. So of the two ladies in the center, the one on the right, Danielle, she's been there working with Jeremy in 2012, and she's still there today managing the council and making sure it operates. So two essential ingredients. The lady on the right has been there from the start managing it, shows continuity, and the lady on the left is the Minister of Tourism who saw the wisdom of keeping it in place and not removing it. Both of those are all too rare. We just don't see people staying in place, and we see too much rotation. One of our messages when we talk to government is first and foremost, bring in a little humility to understand that tourism is more complex than society thinks. It needs internal capacity. I think most of our problems in sustainable tourism today, the government level, have to do with a lack of awareness of what are the issues. They don't even know what they don't know. So if they get some people in that have the staying power, that read the literature, that learn about visitor management. We talk about bad visitor management and over-tourism constantly throughout the world. Well, I would say the primary cause of over-tourism, we've got all of our favorite lists, low-cost carriers, home-sharing economy, whatever. cruise ships, all sorts of things to blame. To me, the central cause is just not being managed well. And all the success stories are in places where they've got some awareness internally that they need to manage, and they're trying to get better at it. So that's that story. Last year, the winner of the same award, Glenn Manzik, standing right here over, it's not standing, he's sitting in the middle of the room, he's photographed in the middle of the photo. He won the award last year. And at Thompson Okanagan Tourism Authority in the Thompson Okanagan region of British Columbia and Western Canada, doing some very progressive things. And they're part of the GSTC framework. He's here with us today, and they're members of GSTC. They got certified by another certification body, and they're doing great things. And two things that I want to highlight of what they're doing that I think is so fabulous is that, was it about 8 years ago, I think, Glenn, that a decision was made that they changed from what most of the world does, and that is where 100% of government spending was on promotion, and they changed it where 60% of government spending was on planning and development and 40% on promotion. And then they stayed with it, and they followed the plans, and today their promotion nets more rewards in terms of average expenditure per visitor and length of stay than they ever did before when all they did was promote. Planning and development succeed. Another thing that on that line, they did a Rails to Trails project that took 5 years to develop, to get all the government agencies involved, to give the permits to create an open public trail for bicycling and hiking. And then beds and breakfasts and bicycle repair shops and all sorts of little businesses developed along the way, and everybody's happy. In my experience, talking to governments around the world, I meet mostly people who have been in tourism in the Department of Tourism for 2 years. All the successful projects we see by government take many years. Do the math, ladies and gentlemen. There's a basic problem, and Glenn and his team have fixed it. The other thing I like very much is that Glenn had the wisdom to reach out to the First Nation community. They have 33 Indigenous First Nation peoples in their province, in their region. And Glenn had the wisdom to reach out to those communities. And the gentleman on the right, Frank, is the chairman of the board. He's from one of those First Nations. And they just did a fabulous job of really truly engaging with those First Nation people. And I think Glenn would support this comment that what I experienced when I was there with you a year ago is that I think this is truly a case where tourism has indeed inspired community and residential life, because I got a sense that the trust and respect of the majority white community and the First Nation people work better today than they did before, because they had this very tangible product, this very tangible development project that was very successful, and everybody is happy. So I think this is a great case along those lines. So congratulations, Glenn. Then the year before, longtime GSTC member and also another early adopter of the GSTC criteria won the award. So what many of us consider the best awards in the world, 3 years running, they used the formula. What better testimonial could we have? There's Graham on the right side as the lead judge of the awards. And Botswana has been engaged with GSTC from the very beginning. So they were one of those 14 early adopters. They had adopted that, the standard. They took it very seriously, pushing tourism businesses to operate more sustainably, setting their policy, doing all sorts of things right. They've got a team of trainers that are training their people. Really, really remarkable record. Richard Malesu, who leads the charge, has been with us so many times at our conferences and activities. He told us that when they applied for World Heritage inscription, that having gone through the GSTC early adopter program and going through the GSTC checklist helped them very much complete the application for World Heritage and helped them prepare for UNESCO World Heritage. So some very interesting case studies that I think tell an important story. So moving on from destinations, a key piece of our work is what we call assurance. And this is a very tricky piece of the world, and I'm going to try to explain a very complex set of things in a few minutes. But one of the things we do in terms of assurance is that with all these different labels out there and certification for hotels, tour operators, and destinations, those who voluntarily come to us and say, we want to keep our standards in place. Maybe it's a national standard, or maybe we're a certification body that operates internationally. We want to keep our identity and our brand, but we want to show to the world that the hard work you did of creating this inclusive set of GSTC criteria exists within our standards. So they voluntarily come to us, and we do an analysis of the words in their standard to show that it includes the GSTC criteria. We call that recognition of standards. It's not any, we don't do any analysis in this process as to how they certify. It's just words in their set of standards. That's a very important distinction. That's the program. So assurance, when we look at it, certification, the power of certification, I believe, is that you, through certification, you verify claims. It provides a discipline for improvement. Anyone who's, you heard it this morning, the process of going through it, all that engagement, checking all those things, it sort of forces you to do all the things that with human nature we might otherwise neglect, right? As an individual, as an organization, if we're not comfortable with something, oh, we'll do it another day. If you go through the process of certification, you make a commitment to go through everything and work on all of it. So I think that discipline is extremely important. Anybody we've ever talked to that's gone through certification says that. They're glad they did it. It was hard work, but it was worth it. And there's a market access function that is very interesting, but we're making that a topic of tomorrow morning's plenary session. We're going to start the day talking about supply chain development by using eco-labeling. So I'm going to pass on that topic for now because we're going to cover it in depth tomorrow morning. We also have a session led by our friend Dr. Xavier Font to talk about the marketing messaging for sustainability, and then we'll do a plenary session tomorrow on supply chain development using. So let's talk about terminology here a second, what we mean when we talk about certification. I don't know if you've heard this expression, third-party certification. We believe third-party certification is the only thing you can truly call certification. What does that mean? A third party is someone that comes into your organization, whether you're public sector or private sector, and analyzes you. They're impartial, and they come and analyze you. Compare that to these other forms you might talk about, verification, starting on the screen at the bottom, zero verification. We just say we reduce plastics, but we don't give you any evidence that we do reduce plastics. That's no verification. That's just talk. But then going up the scale of verification, when you do an internal assessment, we call that first party. That's just you. You as an individual or you as an organization talking about yourself, that's first party. That's not impartial, is it? We can say whatever we want to say about ourselves. I can say I'm handsome, intelligent, and I'm sustainable. You don't know if any of that is true. But if outside parties say it, then you trust that. If that party is still somehow related to your organization and has some bias, we call that second party. If they come from the outside and then they've got the credibility to come in and analyze you and they can pass you or fail you, that's third party. So impartiality is truly key. We don't like to use the term for anything below certification. The word certification is used so loosely. It's not just getting a label. We believe certification is going through a process. So then the ultimate is that third-party certification that's gotten accredited by us. Accreditation means that a certification body has come to us voluntarily. They laid their body open to us for us to examine them like a surgeon. And just like their just like EarthCheck came here and looked at the islands and their operation, we do that to the certification body on a third-party, objective, impartial basis to see how well they're certifying. So this adds credibility to the claims of the certification body, which makes it even stronger to the people that get the certificates. So if you're certified by a certification body that's been accredited by us, it's just going up a chain of more third-party assessment. And remember I said about ISIL Alliance is that we're following their codes. So there's a lot of confusion about labels and so forth. These three very large organizations, Hilton Hotels, Intercruises, TUI Cruises, Arantxa Garcia's here with us, IHG, has Green Engage. These are three mega companies that are global with many locations, and they've done a very clever thing. They've created internal programs as training devices and as measurement devices internally. Well, we're talking to all of these organizations, all three are GSTC members, is that what we're saying to them, and they're trying to figure this out how to do it, is that at the pinnacle of their program, that each individual location and property gets third-party independent certification, and that becomes the pinnacle of the program. So look at this as a scale of upward progress. You can't get certified until you've understood what it is you need to do and gotten assessed and train your staff and set up the green teams and do all the work. And then further along in the process, when you're ready, when you've developed and you're really operating in a sustainable way, then you're a candidate for certification. You can't just walk into certification. It's a process. This is why we say sustainability is a journey. So that's a little bit about kind of the terminology. How it all works in terms of a hierarchy, I've hinted upon a lot of this already. So GSTC has a set of standards. Some certification bodies will certify with their own standard or with the GSTC criteria, right, to the units. When we do our accreditation, we work with a company in Germany called ASI, Assurance Services International. So they're experts on doing the accreditation. So they come into the certification body to do the actual accreditation. All of this is guided by the stuff at the top. I don't expect you to memorize these ISO standards, but I would like you to pay attention to this, is that everything on this hierarchy are based on relevant ISO standards. So for example, ISO 17065 and 17021 define for the world how to certify things. So our accreditation is following, for the certification bodies, how well do you certify according to these ISO standards? We ourselves and ASI follow ISO 17011, which is the world's best guidance on how to accredit. The point is, it's systematic, scientific, we're taking the best guidance in the world in how we operate. A very transparent system, it's a system based on continuous improvement, and it's intended to sort out the serious, the impartial, from those who aren't so impartial and so rigorous in their stuff. So it's a very systematic structure. Then we come to market access, which again I'm going to talk about tomorrow in depth. I'm out of time, but I'm winding down here just a couple minutes of where do we go next as an organization. Well, everything we'll always do will be centered around the GSTC criteria. So we're going to train, raise awareness, talk to people about sustainability based on our criteria. In terms of some other kind of strategic and tactical approaches, we really want to help certification grow. We want good certification to grow. So our next phases of our evolution and development is that we want to get out there and help promote the idea of certification better and integrate it into programs and systems like we've done with some, we're talking to some of those large organizations. TUI Travel is doing that very much, integrating with their internal system based on GSTC. We want to get good at a global system of online data because that'll reduce the operating costs for certification. And getting data gathered on sustainability of businesses will not just support certification, but it can support the market in terms of providing knowledge. So those are important next steps for us. And then also internally is that we really want to work then on the third ISIL Alliance code impacts. So we've been very focused on the standard setting code. We've been very focused on the assurance code. And so now our next step of our evolution is to get more focus on the impacts code. And then we're going to apply next year for full membership of ISIL Alliance. We've been subscribers and adhering to their principles all these years. Very quickly, and a few things on the conference. Thank you to these wonderful media partners that you see on the screen that are joining us and interacting with you. So big thanks to them for your engagement here with us. Thank you to our sponsors, the Azores themselves, Thompson Okanagan. The logo on the bottom is from Thailand, DASTA, the Designated Areas for Sustainable Tourism in Thailand. These are entities that sponsor us in general. And to point out that we have at this conference 250 participants from 42 countries, quite remarkable. We have members in the world at almost 100 countries. So we're truly global, we're multicultural, we're neutral on politics and ethnicity and all that. And so we're just very happy that 42 of you burned a little bit of carbon that I hope you offset to come and join us to make the world more sustainable. Something else I want to talk about in diversity. An organization did some analysis in recent years looking at the boards of directors of travel industry businesses and looking for gender balance. And they looked mostly at private sector businesses, but they looked at NGOs and civil society as well. So many large publicly held travel companies would be 6% women or whatever. And everybody they looked at, civil society and everything, we were the only organization that in 2013 and 2018 had 50% or more of our board of directors as women. So we're a lot about diversity. We're very proud of that. And it's very real in our culture of diversity. Do I have a couple minutes for this? I think we need to do this. So I think you've seen in the e-booklet that Slido, we're using Slido. So let's start using Slido, the app that hopefully you've downloaded from the information that has been sent to you in the conference. So let's pull out your smartphone. If you haven't done so already, Please join us at slido.com and let's practice it a little bit. We'll use this application for Q&A, for questions and answers during our sessions throughout the conference, so we can easily gather audience participation. So let's just get used to it. So if you could kindly go there and find GSTC, and here's the code you enter for the conference to join this event. You need the pound sign, and I think you might, the hash or the pound, you might need to use it twice, GSTC 2019, join. And then let's go ask the, you should see the survey question. Do we have it up? Roy, is it there? Does anybody see the question? What is your preferred term, sustainable or responsible, when we're talking about this topic? Oh, good, people are finding it. Just for fun and just to get the juices flowing on using Slido. I don't know, this isn't so scientific. We'll see what Javier has to say about it, but okay, sustainable is doing pretty well. Well, we'll talk about the terms later. Let's come back to the results in a few minutes because I've already gone over time. So could you come back to my presentation, please? So conference themes. Every conference we do, because we work with the destination criteria, we work with government, at all of our conferences we have one of our tracks on destination management. So we've got a lot of content for the public sector and destination management. We'll always do that. Then we put at various conferences, we kind of mix it up with some other themes. And we try to integrate public sector and private sector together. So some topics are relevant to both, some are a little bit more focused on the other. So for this one, we're going to talk a lot about market opportunities and challenges for sustainable products, and we're going to talk a lot about climate change. So we've got various content and many sessions designed around those topics. We have an amazing group of speakers, and I'd like to say this about the various sessions that we're going to have. We want very much to have a great deal of interaction. This is an amazing assemblage of people. The people that we brought together in this conference, practically every one of you could be on the stage as an expert having something to say. So what we like to do at our conferences is make, you know, and I want to emphasize to the moderators for the conference, we've talked about this, but I can't emphasize enough. We really want you to keep the initial presentation short. We want the audience involved. We want to get a lot of questions and a lot of interaction. We have the opportunity with an amazing amount of talent in this room to have some true synthesis, some true discussion on things. So what we've tried to do is bring some experts on some specific topics, knowing that they're also talking to experts, and set the stage and get the thoughts going and have true discussion. So this is very much our goal for this. So those are our themes. And our goals are to do these three things: learn, share, and partner. Learn, share, and partner. This is our goal. So as we look at the SDGs, SDG number 17 about partnership, we are very much about partnership. We've got our friends at the Travel Foundation doing a session presenting their findings in the Invisible Burden Report. We've got our friends at WWF sharing their results of their work on plastics. And so we're all about partnerships. We think that, you know, we have all these different organizations that have an important part to play. Our part is to have the standards. And we think we also have a part to play to just kind of bring us together in sort of a neutral environment. So learn, share, partner, people. We put long breaks in for networking. We want the moderators to keep the presentation short for interaction. We want learn, share, and partner at every step of the way. So of the 17 SDGs, these three kind of stand out at this particular conference: partnership, 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 networking. Responsible consumption and production, we'll talk about heavily tomorrow. Climate action, we have a session on. So these are our primary goals, but weaving in all of the GSTC criteria, all of the SDGs. Thank you for being here. Thank you for listening. I hope it was helpful, and I look forward to being with you for the next 2 days.
Thank you very much, Mr. Randy Durban, for clarifying some concepts. And wow, 42 countries. I told you at the beginning, this island is definitely the Atlantic meeting room. Now, a third-party verification has told me that you need a refreshment break. And that's what's going to happen. We will have a refreshment break until 11:30. This is the opportunity for you to enjoy the view and do some networking, all right? And think about all the things we'll be talking through these days. See you at 11:30. Cheers.